Welcome to Restaurant Influencers, presented by Entrepreneur. My name is Sean Walcha, founder of Cali Barbecue and Cali Barbecue Media. In life, in the restaurant business, and in the new creator economy, we learn through lessons and stories. We're so grateful for Toast, our primary sponsor of this show, who powers our restaurants here in San Diego, our Cali Barbecue restaurants. They also power so many of the restaurant tours that we've had on this show. We have a very, very special guest, and that's Joe himself, Mr. Chef Joe Isidori, who's a Michelin star chef. He's a restaurateur. He's a cookbook author. This guy has been dominating the streets of Florida and New York for a long time now. Joe, welcome to the show.
Wow. I've never heard anyone say that all about me in one sentence. I mean,
This is called Restaurant Influencers, Joe. We only get the best of the best. We like finding the people that are playing the game within the game.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I always say, you know, when everyone zigs, I zag. That's my thing.
Well, we're definitely zag type of people. Otherwise, we wouldn't be doing what we're doing. Life is too short, and what we're trying to do is influence the hospitality business to know that there's something bigger than just a profit and loss statement in a single unit restaurant. You know, what you've been able to do throughout your career, growing up, and then now what you're doing is legendary. And for us, we want to share those secrets. So I'm going to start with our favorite random question, which is: where in the world is your favorite stadium, stage, or venue?
Yankee Stadium.
Yankee Stadium. Boom.
My family's all from the Bronx. I grew up in Yonkers. I mean, what's better than... Yeah, but whoa. Hold on. I got to go back on that statement. The old Yankee Stadium.
Oh, the old Yankee Stadium.
I remember when I was a kid, we used to clip the fence and sneak into the bleachers and drink Coors Light and eat hot dogs at 12 years old. That was the best.
Okay.
I would say Yankee Stadium takes all of it.
So we're going to go to the old Yankee Stadium. We're going to fill it with, like we say, people that are playing the game within the game. And we're going to put on the best restaurant conference, hospitality conference. But we're going to put you on the mound. We're going to say, Joe, it's your 2-minute drill. Tell these people that came here, raving fans, trying to learn about the restaurant business, the media business. Joe, tell us who you are and what you've done.
Well, what I've done. Listen, I grew up as a kid in New York, and I'm the third generation, chef and restaurateurs in my family. We started it. We've opened them up all over the place: Harlem, Brooklyn, the Bronx, Yonkers, you name it. My grandfather was a master butcher and some say a bookie on 114th and Pleasant Avenue. We had Artie's Bar and Artie's Butcher Shop.
Hey, revenue streams, my kind of guy.
He would sell the beer and a shot to the old guys at the bar, and he'd sell chopped meat to the old ladies. They all play the number. That's where it all started. And then my grandmother was actually Craig Claiborne spoke about my grandmother and her restaurant on 47th and 6th called the Villanova back in 1964. So she was New York Times rated. My father went on to become an acclaimed chef in New York, and I'm a Michelin star chef. But, you know, back in the day, we were just a bunch of schoon buddies. You know, we were like, you know, my father used to say, some people fake shoes, some people lay brick, we cook. And like, it wasn't glamorous. It was like, this is just what we do. You know, don't get ahead of yourself. But everything revolved around it, you know, there was no celebrity chefs. There was nobody getting rich off of the restaurant business. It was just, this is what we do. This is how we do it. We like to take care of people. We serve big portions of food. We're loud. We're in your face. And I try to keep that reputation alive and well till today. So that's kind of who I am. I've been very fortunate that I was the one in my family to take it to the next level. I said to my dad one day, I said, Dad, he said, what? I said, I'm going to go to culinary school. He said, am I allowed to curse on this thing?
Absolutely. This is entrepreneur. This is for entrepreneur.com. I mean, you can't be in business without cursing.
my old man said to me, what are you fucking crazy? Ain't going to fucking culinary school. He goes, I'm not paying all that money for them to ruin your head. They're going to put those ideas in your head. I'll teach you right here. We're going to sling chicken parmesan. It's what pays the bills. I said, okay, Pop. I said, there's a little bit more out there than chicken parmesan. So I went out there and sowed my oats, as they say. I traveled the world. I opened restaurants all over the world, literally Singapore, Dubai, Kuwait, all Disney properties, you name it. And guess what I'm doing? I'm slinging chicken Parmesan today, and I'm telling everybody chicken Parmesan pays the bills. So in the end, the guy, the schoon buddy cook who didn't lay brick or didn't fix shoes was right. And this is who I am, and this is what I do, and now I'm talking to you. But, you know, I've come up with a few tricks along the way.
So what are you working on currently? Tell me about the restaurant, the portfolio.
So I've got a few restaurants now. I've got one in Tampa called Joe Toro, which is a Mexican tequila bar, which is real fun. You know, we're right near the stadium over there in the Amalie Stadium where the Lightning plays. Very sports-centric area. We sell a lot of tacos, sell a lot of margaritas. Everyone loves us, and it's just a fun joint. You know, we also have Everglades Donuts, which is an over-the-top donut concept, which is in Disney World at Disney Springs, which does really well. We do like creative riffs on cold brew, like peanut butter cold brew with the peanut butter explosion donut on top. We have Joe Dog, which is my new hot dog concept that just launched last week. Nice. It's loaded hot dogs, loaded fries, and a lot of fun stuff, all with the big dose of hip hop. We're excited about that. And then the big hit today is Arthur and Sons. Arthur and Sons is that story I just told you about, but all drilled into one restaurant. My grandfather was Arthur Joseph. My father was Arthur Joseph. I'm Joseph Arthur, and my son is Roman Arthur. So it's all those generations wrapped up into one. We call it Arthur and Sons. We serve chicken Parmesan. We sell meatballs, penne alla vodka, Caesar salad, spumoni, tortoni, cannoli, and all the Chianti you can guzzle. And everyone absolutely loves it. And it's been a big media hit. Our spicy rigatoni is going viral worldwide. You got to book 30 days in advance to get in there. You name it, everyone's loving it. There's a big picture of Rakim and there's a big picture of a Sinatra when you walk in. That's our style. That's our vibe. You better get ready, buckle in, because here we go.
Bring me back to the style, because I've read multiple press releases, a lot of the media that you have floating out there. And there was a young boy as a prep cook that was listening to Wu-Tang Clan in the back, and somehow Frank Sinatra was playing in the front. Now you've brought your life's work into one location. Tell me about it.
There's a more of a story to that. So when I was a kid and I used to get in trouble, my mother used to say, you got to teach this kid a lesson. So my father would stick me in the kitchen and tell me to clean 100 pounds of Galamata shrimp. After a while, I got really
good. How old? Give me an age.
Oh, I was at least seven. You know,
my kind of family.
So
hospitality right there.
Oh, yeah. And so I started saying to myself, I get in more trouble now because I could figure out the punishment's not so bad.
Mm-hmm.
So by the time I was about 14, 15 years old, my father figured out, all right, this kid is, we got to use him to our advantage here. So during the day, my father would have me as a prep cook. And then at night I'd go out into the front of the house and be like, you know, a server, a bus boy, whatever I had to do back then. I would be in the kitchen, during the day, pounding chicken cutlets with my headphones on, listening to Wu-Tang, Protect Your Neck. You know what I'm saying? Then I remember taking off the chef coat, putting on the white button down shirt and a bow tie and going outside. It was nothing but Dean Martin and Frank Sinatra. So I figured that was the attitude that I wanted to portray in my restaurant. It's where hip hop meets Sinatra. Our attitude, our style, our vibe, our music, our food all reflects that. And if you follow me on social media, you'll know that my own personality reflects that too. I'm an old school kid. Right. Well, I'm not a kid, but I'm an old school kid from New York. But I've got, you know, I've got a little bit of that young person's eye. I use it to my advantage.
You know, I think one of the things that resonated with me through the content that you put out on TikTok, on Instagram, through your restaurants, through your vibe, is understanding that your truth is your truth. You know, so much of what we try to teach other restaurant owners is when we think of brand and we think of our restaurants, sometimes we try to get caught up in this is our corporate logo, but really they want to know who you are. They want to know who's Joe.
Yeah,
who's Joe comes across in spades.
I'll tell you right now who Joe is. I'm going to tell you right now. Here's a couple of things. Throw your logo in the garbage. Okay. Take your media book that your PR agent gave you, throw that in the garbage too. Everything you see on TikTok that everyone's following trends, throw that in the garbage too.
Correct.
I mean, just abandon yourself from everything and just be yourself.
Yeah.
I've learned that lesson the hard way. And my publicist, Rebecca Brooks, Willie, they're the best. They've been with me for years. And I will say that there was a time where I didn't know what to do. I lost my voice, as artist block, writer's block. I lost it. I didn't know what to do. And they kept just telling me, just be yourself. And I kept saying, but I'm a Michelin star chef. I could cook any cuisine. I can go cook Vietnamese food and open up a Vietnamese restaurant. But is that really going to come across the right way? That didn't make sense. What made sense was being yourself, is my point. I'm a loud, in-your-face New Yorker. As my wife says, you should make good meatballs. You're Italian. and I decided that I was going to just shed the armor, throw it all away. When everyone zigs, I zag. And I was just going to be myself. And that's what I did. That was the game plan. I didn't go and put together an offering and raise money and do all that stuff and hire a digital firm to do the social media. By the way, I do the social media myself with my two guys, Alec and Brian. That's it. Nobody else touches it.
Yep.
And I just said, screw it. I said, when those videos started coming out that you see, there was no game plan. I looked at Alec and I looked at Brian and said, roll the fucking camera. Let's go.
Yep.
Bam. And we just went for it. And I just talked shit. I just did my thing. I probably took some liberties here and there. And you name it, six months or so now, but we started a year ago. We've got ourselves a brand that's going to be huge. And we're going to do a lot of big things. We're going to open up in other cities. We're going to put sauce jars on the shelf. We're going to sell spicy vodka sauce, spicy tomato sauce, vodka sauce. We're going to do a whole bunch of things. And at the end of the day, it's all going to be about one thing. It's going to be about authenticity and New York Italian. It's not Italian American. It's not American Italian. It's not Italian. It's New York Italian, which means it's got that attitude. It's got that flavor. It's got that authenticity. And every time you take a bite, you feel that. And that's the whole part of the brand. And that's why I am sitting here yelling at a computer screen with you.
And now a quick break from restaurant influencers to share an exciting new offer from our sponsor, Atmosphere TV. Go to atmosphere.tv/BBQ to not only get Atmosphere TV for free, but also our audience is given the gift of $200 in ad credits, as well as free activation. Join more than 40,000 other venues who use Atmosphere TV by signing up with the code BBQ at atmosphere.tv/BBQ. Keep guests entertained with Atmosphere TV because you have the ability to turn your promotions and your advertisements onto your television with this platform. The simple plug-and-play device lets you take control of the content on your screens. Keep guests entertained, engaged, and informed of real-time specials, career opportunities, and announcements that you can personalize within your own custom content dashboard. Tap into great channels such as America's Funniest Home Videos, Fashion, Throttle, Chive TV, Sports Highlights, Red Bull, Real Madrid, along with unbiased news and entertainment. There is something for everyone. Over 60 curated channels of short-form, entertaining content to choose from right at your fingertips. They also have an incredible ad-supported network that allows you to not only market within your four walls, but also locally or nationally if you desire. The platform gives you full control to dial in your marketing efforts. Please go and visit atmosphere.tv/BBQ and let them know Restaurant Influencers sent you. Well, it's so important because I heard you on another show that you were on and you were talking about finding your voice, you know, that Michelin star and then getting on to Iron Chef and being at Bobby Flay. And then all of a sudden you realize fuck it. I need to be me. Can you bring us back to that and share that story with our audience?
You know, the Bobby story.
Yeah.
Bobby.
Yeah.
No, you know what it is you always, when you're a young chef, I was that typical young chef. I mean, I pounded on my chest. It was the temple of fucking Joe. If you didn't like it, get out. I mean, literally, I probably threw more people out of my restaurant. That's probably why they all went out of business. But I mean, literally, I was that kind of chef. I was like, you know what? I am lying. Hear me roar. If you don't like it, leave. But the problem was, is I was trying to be somebody else. You know, I was trying to live up to the Michelin hype. I was trying to live up to that attitude. And you start thinking like, all right, I got one star, I need two stars. I got two stars, I need three stars. And you just get caught up in it. And I was probably about, I don't know, 30. I was in my early 30s. and I was on a freaking tear. Like everything I touched was like boom, boom, boom. And you know, that's when I lost my dad, and my dad passed away. He died in his kitchen, and it just kind of sobered me up. And I was like, you know, what the hell am I doing here? I mean, this is ridiculous. I got some of the best restaurants in the country. My bank account is empty. Nobody likes me. I'm a real dick. I'm throwing people out of my restaurant. Like, this is not the way to operate. You know what I mean? This is, something's wrong here, right? And it was at that time that I kind of got invited to go on to Iron Chef and go against Mr. Bobby Flay. And I remember practicing. I remember being so anal and just pouring over every detail. I was like fight with the producer. I need this piece of equipment. I was a total prima donna. And I got on the stage and I realized that Kitchen Stadium was fucking real. I was no stopping. Go. I mean, they looked at me and said, listen, kid, you cut your finger off, the cameras aren't stopping. You keep going.
Yeah.
And I said to myself, I went, oh God, this is real. And it was like my first real big TV thing, right? I'd done all little stuff here and there. And I looked at my two sous chefs and I was like, buckle up, you know, we're going. And I found myself walking into this Kitchen Stadium and we started setting up and something came over me. And I totally, for the first time, became myself. My swagger came out. My accent came out. Like everyone who knew me was like, that's you. All that other shit is you putting on a front, trying to pretend to be somebody else. And I rolled. And even Bobby the whole time was looking at me. We're friends. He was looking at me. He was like, damn, Joe. I was like, come on, let's go. You know, if you watch the episode, I'm like sitting there ripping and roaring and everyone's looking at me like, this guy's on fire. I felt completely comfortable and I felt myself. And I remember at, call it 32 years old, I finally found it, right? It's crazy to say, but I did. You know, since then, I'm 45 now. I've kept on that path and I just do what I do. And if you don't like it, I'm sorry. I apologize, but I don't apologize. It is what it is. Thank you very much. Let's go.
Can you bring me back to losing your father? I know I can't imagine how difficult that was for you, but the lessons that he taught you about hospitality, about hard work, and kind of putting that into perspective now that you're a dad.
Yeah. I mean, my dad, I will promise you I'll do everything in my power to keep my son out of this business.
Good luck, right?
My father tried and he failed miserably.
Couple generations failed.
Yeah. You know, my dad, my mother's the best, right? My mother's come to me. She's like, yeah, you know, I love you. You're my son. I said, yeah, I know. What's up, Ma? Your father, though. Your food's good, but your father's food, wow. I said, thanks, Ma. Thanks for the support. So, you know, and my mother used to say, when my son came home and told us he was going to the Culinary Institute of America, it felt like a funeral in the house.
Oh, no.
I mean, that's that we had. No, seriously, growing up, being in the restaurant business was a curse. It wasn't a gift.
And absolutely.
I still say that to this day. We're not gifted. We're cursed.
Yeah.
We just know how to turn, you know, lemons into lemonade because we're chefs, yep. Right?
Correct.
So my dad taught me a lot. My dad was a big personality. If you took Anthony Bourdain and Al Pacino from Carlito's Way and went like this, that was my father. You know, he was big, he was loud, he was good looking, he smoked cigarettes, he drank vodka, he cooked. He's like 1,500 covers tonight, no problem. I got it. I'll work the line by myself. You know, he was one of those kind of guys with a cigarette in his hand the whole time, and his food was amazing. But he taught me a lot. And you know, I said, Dad, I think I want to be a chef. He says, okay. No more weekends, no more holidays, no more nights. Your girlfriend wants to go out on a date, no dates. You're telling her to meet you here. Like, I mean, he was one of those. He was totally like, your life's over, but you're going to love it, you know? But he taught me a lot of rules. You know, he taught me how to not be fancy and just make everyone happy. He used to tell me I got champagne taste on a Budweiser budget. I need to wake up. He would always tell me chicken parm pays the bills. You know, when I wanted to shuck an oyster and sear a piece of foie gras and dollop caviar on things, he smacked me in the back of the head and said, just put more cheese on it. It'll be fine. You know, and, you know, he also taught me a lot of hard work. My dad never stopped working. And to this day, I'm 45 years old. I run circles around people.
Yeah.
I never stop. You know, it doesn't matter. I'm going to get off this thing with you and I'm going to go do work. I'm going to do something. I'll find something to do. He taught that. He instilled that in me. He also gave me my personality. My father was very much like me. He walked in a room, he dominated the room, and he made sure that I understood how to do that too, because he felt it was important to, he was one of the first people that taught me being a chef means you got to be a personality. Like, people came to his restaurant. Listen, I know my food. I know my food's good. Am I going to tell you it's mind-blowing? Probably not. It's not. But what is mind-blowing is all the shit that I put around it, right?
Yeah.
And that's what my dad taught me. My dad used to be able to cook 500 dinners, right? Cigarette in his hand, a drink in the other, walk out in the dining room and wine and dine people. These people would throw their wallets at them. And yes, they came to that restaurant not because of his chicken parm, not because of his scapriello, not because of his famous dish. They came because of him. Correct. And they came every single weekend or twice a week or whatever. And they had to make sure they saw Artie, said hello to Artie, gave Artie a kiss, bought Artie a drink, because he was what it was, you know? And I learned that at a young age, that you need to be like that. And if you want to be a successful restaurateur and have a clientele that follows you. Now, the difference is he did it in small neighborhoods where he made sure the neighborhood loved him. I'm doing it on a national scale now, you know,
international. You're doing it on the internet.
Yeah.
Internet tape, baby. We're all global. It's a global brand you got here, man.
Yeah. Word of mouth. Artie used to create word of mouth. Yeah. I use social media for the word of mouth now.
Yep.
People come to my restaurant and I get goosebumps when they say it. I walk around the dining room and I feel it.
Yeah.
Like, I'm holy shit. You know, and the people want to talk to me, want to take pictures with me. I'm like, I'm some schmuck from the fucking Bronx. I grew up in Yonkers. What do you want to take a picture with me for? Right. Yeah. And it's reminds me of that's if my dad was alive today and my dad had a restaurant in downtown New York City, I guarantee you he would be worldwide. We'd be calling him Artie Worldwide, Mr. Worldwide. He'd be on every billboard there is. That's the kind of personality he is. And that's what he left with me. And, at the end of the day, you know, the sad story is, you know, everyone loved my father. Mm-hmm. My father gave his shirt off his back. He worked his ass off. He made people happy. He did nothing but bring joy into people's lives. And he owned a lot of restaurants. At the end of the day, when I buried him, he had $265 in his pocket, two packs of Marlboros and lottery tickets. And those lottery tickets were losers, right? My point is he also taught me that you can be better than that. He also taught me that you're going to do all this stuff, but what he left me with a message to say, take care of your life, take care of your kid. There's more out there than just dying in your restaurant. And what social media has done and what I do as a chef and everything, I don't live and die in my restaurants anymore.
Yep.
But I make sure I run my business accordingly, and I make sure everyone's happy. And I make sure they keep coming back. And I can, you know, social media allows me to do that because they still feel me through social media, even if I'm not in a dining room with them. And that has allowed me to, you know, sit here today and do this with you. And after this, I'm going to go have dinner with my son. I don't remember my dad ever sitting with me at 6 o'clock at the dinner table. Yeah. I had to go to a restaurant to eat with him. So, you know, anyway.
No, I really appreciate you going into that, because that was the inspiration for starting this show. You know, we have a barbecue media company. I'm a barbecue restaurant owner, 15 years in the business, but, you know, working in the business instead of working on the business. You know, right now we're more in the business of storytelling than we are in barbecue. And I love barbecue. You know, doing barbecue on the West Coast, not an easy thing to do. Craft barbecue, talking to the barbecue meccas of the world, you know, the Texases, Kansas City, people are like, you're fucking crazy, Sean, you've lost your mind. But for me, what's important is the things that my grandfather taught me. My grandfather was from Bulgaria, and what he cared about was passing on his legacy and his story. So him and I wrote a book together. I helped him write a book. But now what I spend my time doing is teaching not just restaurant owners, but business owners, the power of story. We've never had a greater time that we have these media machines in our pocket, where you can put a video on TikTok, you can put a video on YouTube, you can put a video on Instagram and share your story. Do you have any videos of you and your father? Because as you said, if this stuff was around when he was around, he would break the internet. Break the internet. And now it's your job. It's my job. It's all of our jobs. Anyone that's listening to this show to know that these are the hospitality stories that extend beyond the four walls. This is bigger than our village. This is bigger than San Diego. It's bigger than New York. It's bigger than Florida. What we can do now as leaders is know that our hospitality, our journey, like, this stuff matters. And now a quick break from restaurant influencers to welcome our newest sponsor to the show, and that is Davo Sales Tax. Davo is an incredible company. I remember when we first opened up our restaurant in 2008, Cali Barbecue, we were struggling to figure out how to automate sales tax, how to have enough money in our account to file our quarterly taxes. I am so grateful that now, today, we have found Davo, and they are a sponsor of the show, and they are excited to help other business owners no longer have to become tax collectors. Davo does it all for you. They take care of the compliance, they take care of the collecting, they take care of the filing. Get your first month free by going to davosalestax.com/influencers. Let them know that we sent you. Davo is an incredible company. We're grateful to have them on the show. They integrate with all the top POS companies, including Toast. davosalestax.com/influencers. Automate your sales tax today and get back to running your business. Or what are you doing to teach your son the principles that you've learned from your father?
Yeah, well, he's five right now. So
son's five too. Yeah, he wants to play Roblox. My son's five too.
But I will tell you, you know, it's great when you watch your son grow up. I watch how good of a soul he is. And I just watch him do things. And I say to myself, damn, he's a good kid. Like the kid comes over, hey, that's my toy. I want to play with it. He's like, yeah, that's fine. You can play with it. That's cool. Well, let's go do something. So I see like he's got that good heart, but I teach him, just I want to try and instill that drive in him, that understanding of what needs to be done. He's constantly wants to cook with me, constantly. And I look at my wife and I go, oh man, I know. I said, she's like, it's in the blood. You're not going to be able to get rid of it. So what I'm trying to do now is create that proverbial generational wealth for him. And I don't mean that financially. I mean that by like, all right, if you choose this as your platform, I'm going to make sure I give you a good platform to start off with. Not like me. You know, I had nothing to start off with. You know what I mean? It was my dad was in the trenches and he just dragged me into it. And we just slugged it out together. I'll make sure that, you know, he understands core values from being a person, a chef, and a business person. Businessman that he needs in order to be successful and do the same thing for his children. But it's not easy. It's not easy. And, you know, look, at the end of the day, I never thought I'd go on YouTube or Instagram. My mother went to a high school reunion last week and they went on stage and they said, Denise Forte has a celebrity son. I said, who, me? I was like, my wife tells me I got the biggest line of shit going on to man. I was like, I said, if he was alive, he'd be bigger than life. I'm just trying to fill those shoes as best I can. Listen, this business is not for the faint of heart. It really isn't.
It's not. We talk about lessons and stories, and as great as it is to talk about the successes, we always learn more from the failures and the difficult times and the things that we learn along the way. You've opened up a lot of restaurants, you've sold restaurants, you've closed restaurants. Can you tell me about Black Tap? What did you learn?
Black Tap, my God. Black Tap is a lot. There's a lot to unpack there. Black Tap, so... It's a long story. We got time.
All right, we got time. We're not going any. The people that listen to this show, they need to know the Black Tap story.
So my dad died. Like I said, right? I was, pounding on my chef as a chef, pounding on my chest as a chef, and I just was like, "This is BS." And I said, I was really down in the dumps, and I didn't know what to do. I was broke. I mean, broke. You know what I mean? Like beyond broke, like $5 Chinese special. I broke it up into three meals. Like at my restaurant, I used to literally go buy the 79 cents box of Ronzoni and all the scraps from the stock pot to make a salad. I mean, we were broke and I would wait until at the end to eat. You know, I was never so skinny in my life. I didn't know what to do. And I said to myself, you know what? I was really soul searching. I was like, all I want to do is recreate a memory of my father. That was what I wanted to do. What was my favorite memory? My favorite memory was every Tuesday, he took me to the local luncheonette and I got a cheeseburger deluxe and a milkshake. He got an eggnog. an egg cream, and I got a milkshake. And he used to tell me, "You always got to be fancy, right? Can't have the eggnog like normal people. I mean, the egg cream like normal people." I was like, "Well, you know, come on." And I remember we used to have this like debate when I was a kid. And as I got older, it was the champagne Budweiser thing. You know, get to a legal age. But it was one of my favorite times. So I said, "You know what? This is what I'm going to do." I went and I bought a tiny little place on Broome Street in Soho. It was 700 square feet. I gutted it. I built it out myself with plywood. Like, people used to come in, they were like, "When are you going to paint the place?" I'm not. They were like, "What do you mean? I'm not painting it." I was like, "I'm going to bomb it with graffiti." They were like, wait. "It looks like somebody broke in here and vandalized the place." Perfect. I was like, "That's what I wanted." It had 15.
That's the vibe.
It had 15 seats. It had a little griddle and a countertop fryer. I said, "All right, look, I'm just going to basically recreate this memory of my dad and I sitting at a luncheonette counter, having a burger, cheeseburger deluxe, a milkshake, maybe serve a cool beer. And that's it. Let's see what happens." So I wrote this business model that said, if I do 60 people a day, I could pay myself a living wage. I can make 10% profit, and I can run. I can give my investors, because I had to borrow some money to do it. I bought $225,000 invest. That was it. I could pay my investors back without them coming down on me. I opened the doors and I basically put out a press release for the most part that said, and I'm ad-libbing here, "This Michelin star chef says, fuck fine dining. I'm flipping burgers for the rest of my life." And I swear to you, they were lining up out the door. 72 hours after I opened, it was like, "What the hell is going on?" And I said to my manager, I said, his name was Peter at the time. I said, "Pete, what's going on?" He goes, "They think you lost your mind." I said, "What do you mean they think I lost
my mind?"
He said, "They think you lost your mind. You're flipping burgers. You're like one of those Michelin star chefs going to go jump off the bridge." Yeah. I was like, no. I like this. And we started flipping burgers. And after 72 hours, I had to close the restaurant because I didn't have enough prep. We were doing like 300 people a day. I had to buy another griddle. I had to buy another fryer. I had to get another refrigerator. I had to reprep. If you could scroll back to Black Tap's Instagram back in the day, you'll see a picture that says "closed, got to prep." And I just put my head down and went to work and didn't think anything of it. Right. Next thing you know, we win Burger Bash. Right. Now all of a sudden, now Instagram comes out. Right. And everyone's like, "Oh, this thing, Instagram, you got to get on it." And I'm like, what's this? Right.
Yep. We feel like that. It's so funny with social media. Everybody, anyone that's listening to this, it's like Facebook, Instagram, TikTok,
That's
until it's like, "Oh shit, now I need to be on that."
Yeah. So I got on it and I started looking around and I was like, "This is stupid." I was like, "It's boring." It's like, "What is this?" I was like, "It's like, oh, look at my lunch. I don't want to see your lunch. I don't care about your lunch." Right. "Oh, look, I got a craft beer, 10.8 ABV. Get the fuck out of here." I was like, "This is boring." I was like, and it's all about content. I said, "This isn't content." So I started taking cheeseburgers and I started basically I would take the cheeseburger and I would put like 10 pieces of cheese on it and melt it and just go like this. And you just saw, and it was like, "Oh, okay, that works." Then I started taking two cheeseburgers and I would just like tell it, just play a video, like press record. And I would squeeze in my hand and juice would come down. I'm like, "People really come in here for this?" And it started growing and growing and growing. And we got to like 16,000 followers, which was a big deal back then. This is
huge deal in the beginning.
You know,
still a big deal today. Yeah
we created like this little Instagram community. Like, you'll see like Cheat Day Eats, Brunch Boys, all these handles that are 500,000 to a million followers. When they first started coming to Black Tap, they were all like maybe 10,000 followers, right? Mm-hmm. And we all created this little community. We all grew together. Then one day my wife woke up and she looked at me and she said, "Go to work and make me a cotton candy milkshake." I said, "You're out of your fucking mind. I am not doing that. I got people down the street looking for my cheeseburgers. They love me." She was like, "Listen to me. Cotton candy milkshake." "I'm not on me," I said. "All right." So I went to work, came back for like 2 weeks. She broke my chops. I said, "Come on, please leave me alone." She goes, "Just do it." I said, "Okay, I did it." So I went to work. I got with my social media girls and I said, just do this. Take a picture of it, put it on Instagram. Let's see what happens. Holy shit. I put it on Instagram and it was like, I don't know, say 72 hours. people were running up to the door with their phones going, I want this. I want this. I need this. I need this. And I was just like, I don't have it. Yeah, I just put the picture. And then people started calling us frauds and this and that. And I was like, well, this can't happen.
Yeah.
So once again, we had another milestone. Shut the place down again. Rebuild it. I said, let's figure this out. And I went to my team and I said, I have an idea. They said, you're going to go to, there's a candy store in Chinatown. They sell nothing but these over-the-top gummies. I said, they sell gummy sharks. I said, you're going to buy those sharks. I said, you're going to come back. You're going to make a blue milkshake. You're going to put red frosting around it. You have lots of whipped cream. You're going to have these sharks coming out of it. I said, and you're going to post this post. I said, welcome to Shake Week. It's better than Shark Week. 5 days of crazy shakes coming at you. And the crazy shake was born. And we put up five shakes. At the end of that fifth day, my wife woke me up and said, wake up. I said, what? I got to go to work. I don't. She goes, your Instagram's down. Your website's down. The phone's busy. What's going on? By the time we woke up, by the time we came out of it, we were at like 150,000 followers.
That's insanity.
I went to work and I lived like two blocks from the restaurant at the time. I remember walking to work. It was like 9 o'clock in the morning. And it was no joke. Like 300 people waiting outside to get into a 15-seat burger bar to get these milkshakes. And the rest is history. I went on to open up there. They've done more, but I did 16 locations, 14 of them I opened, you name it, you know, New York, Las Vegas, Disney, Singapore, Dubai, Kuwait, Abu Dhabi, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain. We just, and like my son was born. That kid has got a passport with more stamps in it than you've ever seen. 6 months old. Was in a bassinet on Air Emirates, right? Go first class, going to Dubai to go open up a restaurant.
Come on.
I got pictures of it, everything. This kid has got no idea.
Come on.
One of the craziest times of my life. I lived on the road I must've traveled for a year and a half. And I did all this in 3 years, by the way, 3 years, 16 restaurants, a worldwide brand, a whole nine yards in 3 years. Got to the end of the road and back to the original part of the podcast, I wasn't being me.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, I started Black Tap as a memory I had with my father. And unfortunately, that memory had faded away and Black Tap had become something else. It was eclipsed by the milkshake. It was eclipsed by worldwide fame. And it just became a machine. And I was no longer necessary, in my opinion. So I raised my hand and I said, check, please. And yeah. Took some time off. And that's when I said earlier, I couldn't find my voice. I didn't know what the hell to do. Did a few things here and there, but still no voice. And then I said, you know, I know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna recreate my father's restaurant. Once again, off a nostalgic memory that I had. Look what I am today. Another worldwide hit, another Instagram and TikTok phenomenon, another story to be told, another proof in the pudding that being real, old school, authentic is the only business plan you need. Don't worry about the bottom line. Don't worry about the P&L. Don't worry about all that other BS. Be yourself, do your thing, be passionate, work hard, and you will succeed.
That's incredible advice. I think, you know, we have so many restaurant owners that listen to this show. We're fortunate that millions of people since we've launched the show have either listened to it, watched it. And I know how hard it is because I've done it and I'm still doing it. We're still in the barbecue business and the media business. And
crazy.
Trying to figure out, you know, where is that point? And when I had my son and my daughter, those were the first times in my life that I looked at myself and I said, Sean, I can't be in the restaurant 7 days a week. You know, I don't want to be an absentee father. I don't want to wake up and realize that my kids are grown and we haven't made any money, you know, like back to what you're, you know, when your dad passed away. I don't want that to be for me. And I want, and it's not about the financial side of it. It's about the legacy side and the impact side. What kind of life can I live for my child and for my daughter? How do you be a good husband?
Do anything she wants you to do.
Is that the answer? Is it a happy, that's how you keep
it? I'm telling you right now, I'm the luckiest guy in the world. My wife, any other woman would have divorced me by now. No woman can handle a chef or a restaurateur. It's the most difficult thing in the world. We're always on. We're always going. We're always spending money. We're always making. It's like, I'm rich. I'm broke. I'm rich. I'm broke. You know? And
pretty much.
My wife is, I bounce everything off my wife. Her and my attorney. Those are my two consiglieri.
Consiglieries right there. Yeah.
But she really, really, really supports me, and to a point where I think she's a little fucking crazy too.
Yep.
But
oh yeah, 100%.
And it wouldn't work if she didn't. So, you know, I've seen a lot of restaurants. My dad was married like 3 times. Are you kidding me? He couldn't. You know, they were just like, I'm out of here. I see what this is. This guy smells like galamad and garlic bread all day long. I don't need to be around him. You know, it's just a tough life. So having a great wife is one of the most important things. It won't work without it. And I'll tell you right now, you could try and be that tough guy. Oh, I don't need a wife. Yeah, bullshit. You know, you can't do this alone. It's not going to happen. You're not going to have any sort of life. You know, one of the things I say all the time is, you know, our industry has seen quite the reckoning over the past 5 years. And there's a lot of great things that have come about it. There's a lot of bad things that have come about it. But one of the most important things is it taught us how to have, or gave us the opportunity to finally have a way of life. I don't think it existed 5 years ago. Yeah. I think 5 years ago, I would have probably, if it would have stayed the same, maybe a little longer than that 5 years ago, but I would have probably just drove myself into the ground in the restaurant like my father did. But today you wake up between, how people are aware of mental health, diversity, inclusion, in a very inclusive environment, all those things, you know, people say what they want to say. And, you know, there's both on both sides, they all have their beef. But in the restaurant business, man, it was sobering. It really helped us because you look at your employees differently now. They look at you differently now. I can sit here and do this without having to worry about doing, it's 4:45 right now. I'm supposed to be doing pre-shift and I'm here talking to you. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Think about that. 5 years ago, if you would have asked me to do this podcast at 4:45, I would have called you every name in a book. You delusional POS. Get out of here. I got something to do, right? But the world has changed, and I'm so grateful for it because it's provided me, you know, a lifestyle that I never thought I'd have. And, you know, here I am talking shit with you. So
I love it. I love it. So some parting wisdom for anybody that's listening to this, you know, the chef that's out there that doesn't believe in social media, or they're ready. They're listening to enough content. They see enough things going on TikTok, on YouTube, on Instagram, on podcasts. And they're like, why is everybody else getting the attention? What we try to do is say, no one's coming to tell your story. You have to own your own story. What kind of advice do you have to that chef, to that restaurant owner, to that big restaurant group that's literally sitting there wondering, hey, what's going on? Is the world passing me by?
No, it's real simple. I'm old school kid. Knock it off and cut the bullshit out. So cut really, the bullshit. Wake up and knock, right? I mean, don't
get over yourself.
Get over yourself. Do what you got to do. You know, just be yourself. Find your own voice. Find your own way. Don't worry about what people are going to think. If you try to be someone you're not, then they're going to say something about you. If you act the way you're supposed to act and you be who you are, they can't say anything. You're bulletproof then. Just do it. Don't be afraid of it. Okay. It's like, listen, you know, it's like my brother is very handy, right? He does a lot of construction. I'm good at construction too, but I'm good at telling people what to do and not actually doing it. And he says, you just gotta do it, he says, right? So my advice to you is knock it off, stop the bullshit, and just do it. It will work, it will happen. Invest in it. And as many great entrepreneurs have said before, trust the process.
Trust the process. So if you guys want to reach out to me, it's at Sean P. Walchef, SHAWNPWALCHEF. Every week on Wednesday and Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific time, 1 p.m. Eastern time, we're on the audio app, social audio app Clubhouse. And we want you guys that are listening to the show to join us, to come up on stage, share your story, tell us about your restaurants, tell us about your content creation, what you're trying to do for your restaurant. And we also give a shout out. So this week's shout out is going to Ryan Mondragon. And he is at Sanctuary_pizza on Instagram and on TikTok. He has a pizza, craft pizza food truck concept out of Turlock, California. Ryan, thank you for showing up. And Chef, I want to give you an opportunity to give a shout out to someone on your team, someone that doesn't get it. This is going on entrepreneur.com. Millions of people are going to get it. Who gets some love today?
My whole team gets love.
The whole team.
The whole team.
Let me know who they are.
Freddie, Tia, Herman, Angel, all of them. I love them all. They all, Jim, Shamika, all of them. They're all doing great. And I love everybody. I love my whole team. I wouldn't be here without them. And, you know, follow us on Instagram at Arthur and Sons, at Arthur and Sons on Instagram and on TikTok. You get to see me, you get to see the team, you get to see what we do. And, can't be a podcast without a shameless plug.
Please.
Soon, coming soon to stores near you, our tomato sauce will be on the shelves. Keep an eye out in the new year. Go buy my sauce.
Follow at Joe Isidori. Follow at Arthur and Sons. We're going to put links in the show notes. You can follow me. Reach out. Stay curious. Get involved. Don't be afraid to ask for help. Chef Joe, it is truly an honor. If you make it on the West Coast, if you make it to San Diego, please come enjoy some barbecue on us. That goes for anybody that's listening to the show. You guys are all VIPs. We'll roll out the red carpet of Cali Barbecue. Take care of you, your team, anybody that makes it out here. So thank you, Chef Joe. Hope to visit you in your restaurants one day.
You got it. Can't wait to have you.
Boom. And a special thank you to our title sponsor, Toast. Toast is the primary technology partner that we use at our restaurant, Cali Barbecue. It is also the primary technology partner that so many of the guests have shared with us on this show. People like Sam, the cooking guy, Stacy Poonkinney, Jeff Alexander. So many times the guests tell us that they're using Toast when we didn't even know that going into the interview. That is why we are so grateful that they sponsor this show. We want you to win. You that listen to this show, we want you to improve your digital hospitality. Toast is built for restaurants and it's built for you. Toast is the restaurant first platform that's built for your needs, whatever your size, concept, or ambitions. Improve your bottom line with a customizable platform that's easy to learn, use, and grow with. And it meets you where you are with all the right tools for your price point. If you have any questions about Toast, please DM me at Sean P. Walchef, S-H-A-W-N-P-W-A-L-C-H-E-F. I will get you the link to the right Toast contact in your market. It's so important that if you listen to this show, that you win. We want you to be on this show eventually. Let us know that you heard the show, you heard about Toast, you implemented Toast, you did a Toast unboxing in your restaurant. Talk to us about how you've impacted your village, your city, your community. Share your Toast story with us. DM me today to learn more and be sure to check out Toast.